health and things, and I kind of shared with her my weight loss journey. So I was actually pretty chubby as I was a kid, and then, you know, when you are chubby, there's like things going on, like bullying does happen. So I did get called like hanging on the bus and bacon and all of that, like really nice stuff. So it did happen. And then as I was like a preteen and a teenager, like when you're having these types of issues, they don't really go away. You know, sometimes they do, sometimes they don't, but when you're having these issues, they tend to just kind of like keep happening, right? So if you have an attachment to food, or you have, you know, an issue with exercise, then you're going to just keep having that, right, until something changes. So that kind of went on all through middle school, all through elementary school. Unfortunately, I didn't change school, so the same group of people that were bullying me were there all throughout. So it was kind of like a weird social situation. And then when I was 23, I got extra fluffy. As you can see, it does happen. And a lot of that had to do, and what I want to talk about today is with like emotional eating. So kind of what we're talking about here is when you're eating, when you're not hungry, but you're eating because of an emotion. So like, who here eats when they're bored? I do it. Not perfect. Who here eats when they're sad? Okay. Who here eats when they're just like kind of mad and they had a bad day? Okay. For some of you, like, you only eat when you're hungry, and good for you, because that's not me. Sometimes I just think I'm hungry and I'm not actually hungry, and we're going to talk about that too. The main thing I really want to talk about is like how you think about food. So like how you're thinking about it, because everybody is just kind of mindless with it. I know that you see just with adults too, like having weight issues or whatever, eating things you know aren't the best for them, and why do we do that? So one thing I really want to talk about that changed for me between being heavy and not being heavy, as you saw in the picture, was, am I being nice to my body? So in this culture, everybody says like, oh, I'm having a bad day, I'm gonna have a muffin, or I'm just gonna Netflix and chill and have some snacks. Like, everybody knows you're kind of like, treat yourself, right, when you're not feeling it. And that's kind of the wrong way to look at it. Like, your body is a machine, right? And I'm sure they talk a lot about like digestion and like how your body deals with stuff. So you really have to think about, like, when you're eating, and I eat fun stuff too, but when you're eating like chips and cookies and like naughty things, that you're putting kind of like gunk in your engine, you know, and your body's just gonna feel icky. So I know that you know the difference when you eat something healthy, you feel kind of good, right? And you're feeling like, all right, yeah, like, let's go get the day. Or like, if you eat a big greasy meal or a big piece of pizza, you're like, that was good, but now I'm ready for a nap. Does everybody kind of feel that? Like, eat something heavy and you're like, I need a nap now? Yeah. Okay, so am I being nice to my body? Really thinking about like healing your body through foods, you know that you can be nice to your body. So instead of thinking about food as pleasure or as punishment, a lot of times people will skip meals, or they'll be like, oh, I'm gonna have a salad because I need to lose weight, or I'm gonna have a salad because I, you know, whatever, I'm being naughty. And like, a lot of times you'll hear like, maybe your parents are kind of going through that, or your parents are going through like trying to eat healthy or trying to go on a diet, and it feels kind of like being smushed, right? So you want to look at food as fuel instead of like, am I trying to please myself or am I trying to punish myself? And then another thing I really want to talk about with emotional eating is like, who told me the things that I'm saying to myself, and are they true? So everybody has kind of like that running dialogue in your head, right? That like little voice that just kind of talks to you all day. And sometimes that voice isn't super nice. Hopefully that voice is nice. I'm hoping that for you guys. But sometimes it's not. Sometimes it says like, oh, I can't, oh, I don't want to, oh, I'm not good enough, or I'm not smart enough or strong enough or whatever, like that little voice. And I want you to, the next time you're having like any kind of icky thoughts about yourself or about what you can do, like you're trying something new. I know like the first time I went to like ride a bike, I threw it. Like, I remember throwing it because I got so mad that I couldn't do it. And you're talking to yourself like, I can't do it. So I want you to really think about like, what are you saying to yourself, and like, are they actually true? So that's a big thing when you're thinking about food. Another thing is just like really restrictive. So I know that when people say like, on a diet, like I have to eat the smallest amount, or I can only have a little bit, right? I can only have a little bite. And you don't wanna restrict what you're eating, because you're gonna mess with your head. You're gonna make yourself feel like you're not allowed to eat, right? No one wants to feel like they're not allowed to do something. And like, what happens when your parents say like, don't do that? Are you more interested in doing it? Do you kind of feel more like they're like, I need you guys not to touch this thing? You're like, yeah, but now I want to touch the thing that you said I shouldn't touch it, right? It's the same thing with food, and even adults have a really hard time with that. When they go on a diet, how many people do like their New Year's resolution and then they fall off like the next week? Has anybody seen that? Like with your parents? I don't know if your parents like talk to you about New Year's resolutions. I don't know how much your parents share with you. I would tell my kids about myself. But so I don't have kids yet, by the way. If you're wondering, I don't have kids. So you want to eat better, not less. You want to just be nice to your body. Like eating well is a form of self-respect, and you just want to be nice to your innards. Okay. And I want to talk a little bit about childhood obesity, because I know that it is an epidemic that's happening now. So when I was a kid, I was like one of two chubby kids in the whole school. And so now it's like half, like almost half of students. So one in three children are overweight. Like they watch way too much TV, they're eating way too many calories, way too many snacks. Like I know when I was in that really heavy place, I would go to school, I'd come home at 3, I would just be horizontal till bedtime. I would like watch TV, I would eat snacks, I would wait for dinner, and then go to bed. That's not healthy, right? You need to be moving your body.
Don't forget about video games.
Video games. Right, like playing video games, playing on the computer. I didn't have a cell phone when I was a kid, but I know all of you probably have a tablet, or a tablet is around, or a phone is around. I know my niece and my nephew are tablet junkies. So either way, you're like, you're sitting and you're not moving your body. So that's a big thing, talking about junk, spending too much time in front of a screen like we talked about, and then just eating a lot of sugar. Everyone knows that sugar is really fun, but it's not really good for you. Okay. And then this just talks a little bit about diabetes. I try not to put too many like boring stats in here. I'm not like a numbers person. It's not my thing. But I did want to talk about that a little bit because it is happening. Like our students are having diabetes happen, and it is a challenge. You can't read the little tiny words. But basically your pancreas stops working. So your pancreas helps regulate your sugars. And when you kind of like beat it up, when you have too many sugars, it stops working. Like it can't regulate what you're doing. So now we need medications. Now we have to be extra careful with our foods, and it's an even bigger challenge. So Missy, I can talk to you more about that if you want. I don't want to be a bummer. Okay. So again, something I just really wanted to focus on. Did you have a question? You have what? You have diabetes. You have like the type 1 or the type 2? Type 1. So the type 1 happens when it just comes from your hereditary, right? Like it just kind of happens. And then type 2 is from food, right? Yes. So there are two types of diabetes. So just so you guys know, like some is just hereditary, and you have to kind of work with your body and kind of like pay attention to those things. It just kind of happens. And then type 2 is when it comes from diet. Like you have had a hard time kind of figuring that out. In both situations, your pancreas is having a hard time, and we have to be even nicer. Exactly. So insulin is kind of like, it's the chemical that comes out when your body's trying to regulate sugar. So when your pancreas isn't producing insulin, it cannot regulate the sugars that you're eating. Does that make sense?
Okay.
Thank you for the technical words. I was like skipping over that. So yeah, thank you for that. So when you're eating healthy foods, you're filling your body with energy and nutrients, and you imagine yourself smiling back at you saying thank you. So that was one of the things that really helped me when I'm talking about like being nice to my body and being nice to my cells. Like think about what they want to eat. What does your body want to eat? Not just what does your mouth want to eat? Because my mouth just wants like, I don't even know. carbs, cookies, all those fun things. So emotional eating, I know we touched on this a little bit. So boredom eating to avoid discomfort or being present. So have you ever like, you're just trying to like distract yourself? I know if I'm trying to study something and I don't really feel like doing it, I nibble. It's a thing, stress eating to distract yourself from anxieties. So like, I don't know if you guys are into like FCATs, you guys do that, or like any sort of like big tests in the school? No, you guys are safe from that kind of stuff?
Well, actually they have one coming up, the end of the year tests.
Ooh,
there's
okay.
Four big ones that they have to take, I know.
Does anybody get nervous about test taking? Yeah, I did too, because I wanted to like get straight A's and be perfect. It was like my thing. So a lot of pressure and like worrying about that. So like stress eating is definitely a thing. Social eating to celebrate just because food is available, and then loneliness eating to suppress feelings of incompleteness. more depressing verbiage than I thought was there. But yeah, so social eating, I know she was kind of talking about that before. Like, there's a lot of foods that you eat with your family that it's just like a celebratory thing. And I know for me, I work in an office, every single time somebody has a birthday, there's cake. Luckily, I'm vegan and I can't eat most things anyway, because I don't want that. But if I had cake every single time it was someone's birthday, I'm having cake a lot. I'm having cake like 3 or 4 times a month, and it's, you know, that would be a lot, right? So just eating because food is around. I'm at a party, there's a bunch of food around. Maybe I ate before the party, but now I'm eating again just because. You're trying to like keep yourself busy. So why does emotional eating happen? We're kind of talking about that. How can we recognize it? Like paying attention, like are you actually hungry or just eating because it's fun? And what can we be doing instead? Okay. So I don't know if anyone goes through this. This is like pretty detailed, but if you're having like I was talking about before, a stressor, then cortisol is actually a stress hormone. So it's a hormone that your body produces when you're stressed out and upset. And cortisol does a lot of things, but it's not a good thing. So when that's released, now you're kind of binge eating. You're eating things that you don't really want to eat, but you're eating them anyway, or like you're overeating, so you're trying to feel better. Serotonin and dopamine, those are like feel good. Those are like feel good hormones. So after you're dancing, do you feel like happy and calm, or like excited, like after you like did something fun, right? So that's serotonin and dopamine. That's what that feels like. And then you're feeling better for a minute, but then once those feelings wear off, you feel kind of guilty because you ate a bunch of stuff. Now your brain kicks back in and you're like, oh, I probably shouldn't have done that. So now that guilt makes you more stressed, and then you kind of start all over. So y'all might not experience this, but it is a thing that happens, and it happens to kids, teens, adults, all of that stuff. Okay. I wanted to talk a little bit about like emotional hunger versus physical hunger. So emotional hunger is when you're like, oh my gosh, I'm hungry. Like you just ate like a little bit ago, but now you're hungry all of a sudden. You really need to eat right now. You're craving something specific. You're like, oh, I want something salty. I want something sweet. You eat quickly and usually in private. I know that was a thing for me. My parents were aware that I had a bit of a chubby issue, so then they were trying to make sure that I wasn't overeating, which made the problem worse, because then I would sneak food. I know my niece and my nephew sneak food too, it's a thing, and they're not even overweight, but sneaking food is a thing. So you eat quickly, usually in private. You're not satisfied with a full stomach, so you still feel like eating, even though you're not really hungry. And then after eating, you feel kind of like icky, shame, or like powerlessness. What does powerlessness mean?
Like you feel weak.
Yeah. Feel weak and kind of just sad. So physical hunger, this is when you want to be eating. When you're like, you start to get hungry, it takes a while. You can wait. You're like, ugh, I'm hungry, but I can chill for a bit. Any food sounds good. If you've been super hungry, you're like, I don't even care. I don't even care what it is. I'll eat it. That's me most of the time. You take your time with eating with good company. You stop eating when you're full, and after you're eating, you don't feel bad about yourself. Because most of the time when you eat lunch, it's just like, yeah, I ate lunch. Like, there's no weird emotions to have, right? Okay. So food is fuel, not therapy. That is a thing. And then some of the ways to manage emotional eating. So if you're feeling really stressed, and some of you might struggle with this, some of you might not, or you might struggle with it later. Maybe I'm planting a little seed for you guys later on when you're having an issue. But what can you do instead? Like, take a deep breath and think, like, am I actually hungry? If yes, eat mindfully. What does mindfully mean? Anybody want to guess? Like when you're being mindful.
Like respectation.
Yeah, so when you're being mindful, you're being like, you're really thinking about it. Like, you're really thinking about what you're going to do. So you're eating mindfully. You're checking with your hunger cues. You choose what you want. You be mindful about what you're eating. Paying attention to your senses and emotions. If you're not hungry, ask yourself, how am I feeling? Like, what's kind of going on? You know, because if you're an emotional eater, because I know that I go through this, like, how am I feeling? Like, how can I self-soothe? And so for now, I'll go for a run. Or, like, I don't like the gym. I don't like lifting weights. Most of them kiddos even, like, do that. Some kids do. I don't know. But, like, gymnastics, things like that, I always wanted to do something fun. Like, I never want to feel like I'm working out. So for me, it's running or it's Zumba. Has anybody ever tried Zumba? Like, kid Zumba? Okay. I should have brought my workout pants because we could do Zumba together next time because it's really fun. I'm also a Zumba instructor and Zumba is like way more fun than talking about food. Yes.
Zumba.
Zumba is like a Latin-based dance fitness thing. So it's where you like dance and exercise. So I might be like doing a salsa and then I also will be doing like some squats. So you're kind of like exercising and dancing. It's really fun. Anyways, does that make sense at all? I don't know. I can play a song and do a dance for you if you want to.
Okay.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. You have to do it with me.
Okay.
Is that fair? Okay. I'm not going to dance by myself. Okay. We'll do that after.
Yes.
And we're almost done. We're going to talk about some sad stuff and then we'll wiggle. Does that sound like a deal?
Yeah.
Okay. So I want to talk to you a little bit about bullying, and I know that this school is really aware of those things. I think that's really awesome. So am I being bullied? Have I ever been a bully to others? Why am I thinking these negative thoughts? Am I trying to understand those around me? And how does the negativity affect those around me? So I even caught myself in later years being a bully. And you might not be like, well, I'm a bully and I'm just being everybody. Like, you might just have a bullying moment where you're just like, I don't like that girl or I don't like that guy. And then you say something or you whisper about them, and you have to really think about that because you can really, really hurt someone. So who here has had their feelings hurt by something someone said? Yeah, everybody. So you have to really, even if you're not raising your hand, it's probably happened. If it hasn't happened, then good. I hope your feelings don't get hurt. But have I been a bully to others? Like, have I said something that's hurt someone else's feelings? And like, maybe I meant to do it, maybe I didn't. Like, I have done that. So it's something that even as an adult, we go through all the same stuff. Like, we have to work with people. We have to be around people that might not be our favorite. I might think, like, that guy's really annoying. Doesn't matter. He's still a being. We still have to love and care for our fellow brothers and sisters, right? I sit near some people at my job that aren't my favorite, but here's the thing. Like, there's still a being. Like, I know you guys talk a little bit about spirituality. Like, it's still a child of God. Like, you really still have to respect that. Like, you wouldn't, like, kick one bunny but not another bunny. They're both bunnies, right? Oh my goodness, bunnies are my favorite. So that's awesome that you have bunnies.
I live on a farm with a bunch of bunnies.
Oh my goodness, that's crazy.
Baby ones.
Baby ones, yeah.
I just got born.
Oh. So you wouldn't like love one bunny more than another bunny, right? And so you have to think of like all bunnies, right? All the people around you. So these are just stats on bullying. Like one in four teachers. We don't want to talk. One in four teachers see nothing wrong with bullying and will only intervene 4% of the time. I know that's not the case here, but that does happen. And 77% of students have been bullied by others. So I thought this tree was cute. I wanted to share with you. Like, it isn't nice to cut others down. Side tree. We don't want to be mean to anybody. Okay. So these are just some good quotes. Be cool with yourself and kind to everyone. Spoken words can't be erased. Don't blurt what might hurt. Nobody's perfect. That's why pencils have erasers. So one of the things that I really noticed was when I wasn't being nice to somebody else, it's because I wasn't thinking nice thoughts about myself. So it's something to be aware of. And then I have some more quotes here. Never look down on someone unless you're helping them up. Pulling someone down will never help you reach the top. And strong people stand up for themselves, but the strongest people stand up for others. So I know that like bullying is like an awkward topic, and you never want to be like getting involved in someone else's stuff, right? Like two kids are having an issue, you don't want to like get them in there. But it really is the right thing to do. What if the person being bullied was your little brother or your little sister? Like, you would want to protect them. So you really have to think of everybody in that way. We have one more, we're done. So treat others the way you want to be treated. Everybody knows that. Do what's right, not what's easy. Like I was talking about, like you're treating everybody like your brothers and sisters, you won't have that issue. And then, we're snagging somebody. And then before you speak, think, is it true? Is it helpful? Is it inspiring? Is it necessary? Is it kind? So. No, you're totally good. I'm actually done with this. We're going to talk about Zumba for a minute, but you're totally good to go. Okay. So, I don't know if I want to bring one up on the projector. I'm actually in stretchy pants, so we can do it. So after you eat your watermelon,
put
that you want
on
to
there.
Do...
Put it on YouTube if you want.
No, on YouTube. Okay.
That's easy.
I'm trying to think. I'm gonna pick a song.
Oh, you wanna do it on your, you wanna do it on that?
Yeah, well, no, you can, I'll pull the, let me pick a song really quick and then I'll pull it up on here. I don't need you to watch anything, you can just follow me.
Yeah.
But just so the sound is loud.
Yeah, the sound.
I'll pick an easy song so we're not going crazy with our feet. Okay, cool. Let's do.
What song are you looking for?
Let's do Fireball. Look up the song Fireball by Pitbull.
Oh.
Me too.
Are you playing with your wand?
No. Oh, there's people coming to look at us.
People!
Well, guys, they should look now before we get dancing. Yeah. Okay. Y'all want to see if you were in a row here? You'd be okay. Oh, that's true. I'm totally okay with dancing with people watching this.
There you go.
How I teach. Right?
Yeah.